Almighty God.
Restore my soul.
Guide me down the path of righteousness.
Give me understanding of your ways.
Turn my eyes from worthless things.
Give me life through your world.
Reassure me of your promise.
Help me abandon my shameful ways.
Create in me a clean heart.
Renew my life with your goodness.
And sustain me by the power of your Holy Spirit.
As we join in worship this day.
you pray with me? O God, we gather together in your presence with expectation, hungry for an encounter with you and eager to hear your word. Open our eyes and ears to the presence of your Holy Spirit. May the seeds of your word scattered among us this day fall on fertile soil. May they take root in our hearts and lives and produce an abundant harvest of good words and deeds. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our teacher and our Lord, who taught us to pray in this way. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's turn our attention now to Pastor Adam and the message for today, forgiveness in real life.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome and welcome back, as would be the case for many of you, whoever you are. We're certainly glad you're here with us today. So we're spending August in the Psalms here, and with 5 Sundays in August to explore just a few of the 150 Psalms, we began last week, of course, with the 23rd. The 23rd Psalm is a psalm written by King David. We're going to stay with the writing of David again this week as we explore the 51st Psalm, and Cecily Hughes will be sharing this psalm with us today.
Generous in your in love, God give grace. Huge in mercy, wipe out my bad record. Scrub away my guilt, soak out my sins in your laundry. I know how bad I've been. My sins are staring me down. You're the one I've violated, and you've seen it all. You've seen the full extent of my evil. You have all the facts before you. Whatever you decide about me is fair. I've been out of step with you for a long time, in the wrong since before I was born. What you're after is true from the inside out. Enter the conceive a new true life. Soak me in your laundry and I'll come out clean. Scrub me and I'll have a snow white life. Tune me in a foot trapping song. Set these once broken bones dancing. Don't look too close to blemishes. Give me a clean bill of health. God, make a fresh start in me. Shape Genesis week from the chaos of my life. Don't throw me out with the trash or fail to breathe holiness in me. Bring me back from the gray axle. Put a fresh wind in my sail. Give me a job teaching rebel from your ways so the lost can find their way home. Commute my death sentence, God, my salvation God, and I'll sing anthems to your life given ways. Unbutton my lips, dear God, let those with who you your praise, through those the motions don't please you, a flawless performance is nothing to you. I learned God worship when my pride was shattered, heart shattered, life ready for love. Don't for a moment escape God's notice. Make Zion the place you delight in. Repair Jerusalem's broken walls. Then you'll get real worship from us. Acts of worship, small and large, includes all the bulls. They can heave into your altar.
So throughout this psalm, as you probably heard, David made some 21 requests of God for some kind of restoration. So what's going on here in Psalm 51? Well, today we're going to deal with everybody's favorite topic, your sin, and mine as well. For those of us who are genuinely seeking a close fellowship with God, we know that our sin is what disrupts that fellowship. Our sin affects our spiritual temperature, so to speak, and the sin in our lives can keep us from that closeness with God and sometimes keep us even from the desire to be close with God. So I want to begin here with our idea of God, okay? Who we believe God is, how we believe God operates, how God kind of deals with us. Easily one of the most recognizable and famous sermons ever preached in the English language was delivered on July 8th, 1741 in Enfield, Connecticut by Jonathan Edwards during the Great Awakening in colonial America. And I'll bet many of you will recognize the title of that sermon, Sinners in the Hand of an Angry God. The angry God was the dominant motif of the revivalist preaching that shaped the church in our nation's infancy. The wrath of God and threats of condemnation and hell, these were the dominant stories that informed the conscience of the church here in America's early years. As we know, stories are powerful things. The narratives we buy into shape what we believe and shape how we live. So, is God angry? Is this the grand story that the Bible gives to us about God? Well, one thing we can say for sure about the God of the Bible is that God makes covenants. God enters into agreements with human beings. Scholar N.T. Wright writes helpfully about God's covenants with humanity, God's judgment on sin, and God's love for God's creation. He says, "The normal objection to theories of atonement and redemption that focus on divine anger is that this seems to run contrary to the deepest themes of the New Testament. Now, of course, divine anger at human rebellion, and particularly at the rebellion of the chosen people, features prominently through Israel's scriptures. Similar notes are struck in the New Testament, not least in the teaching of Jesus himself, and suggestion that sin does not make God angry, a frequent idea in modern thought as a reaction against the caricatures of an ill-tempered deity, needs to be treated with disdain. When God looks at sin, what he sees is what a violin maker would see if the player were to use his lovely creation as a tennis racket. But here's the difference. In many expressions of pagan religion, the humans have to try and pacify the angry deity. But that's not how it happens in Israel's scriptures. The Bible promises redemption, and these redemptions have to do with God himself acting because of his unchanging, unshakable love for his people. So friends, biblically speaking, our overarching story of God should be the story of God's covenant faithfulness. God's love for creation, God's love for humanity, God's kindness towards us that invites us back into relationship with God and back into redemption, even and perhaps especially when we've lost our way. The overarching story of the Bible is not a God so angry, so disgusted by us that God is just looking for reasons to strike us down. See, when fear is our motivator, we're going to do just enough to placate the angry deity, right? And we're going to see as well just how much we can get away with before the deity's anger is once again provoked. Friends, this is not at all what's going on in Psalm 51, is it? We established last week that David, the author of this psalm, knew God pretty well. David had experienced the loving comfort and refreshment of God, which we read about last week in the 23rd Psalm. And so David appeals to God here in verse 1. David appeals to the character of this God he knows so well. And what is it that David appealed to? To God's grace, right? To God's love, God's compassion. Be gracious to me, God, according to your faithful love, according to your abundant compassion, David says, blot out my rebellion. So two things here as it relates to our sin. One, we can be thankful that God's character is as it is when it comes to our sin. And two, a great place to start when it comes to our sin is right where David started, with confession. We see in the first couple of verses here, David refers to his rebellion, his guilt, his sin. So what do we mean by sin? Well, I think Professor Wright gave us a pretty good definition. Like he said, if someone gives us a violin, we don't use it for a tennis racket, do we? A violin is made for music. So that's what it is to be used for, to make music. God created this universe with and for shalom. Shalom in creation is peace. It's all of creation flourishing. It's everything in creation as it should be. So sin, quite simply, is anything that we do, or sometimes even the things we don't do, that messes up this shalom, this universal peace, this flourishing. So in the church, we talk a lot about sins of commission and sins of omission. Sins of commission are things that we do to mess up creation's shalom, and sins of omission are the things we could do, things we fail to do to establish or reestablish creation's shalom. David recognizes in Psalm 51, he messed this up. David has strayed away from the right paths of God that he knew, the right paths that we heard about in Psalm 23 last week. David knew that he missed the mark of God's holiness, another definition of sin that we hear quite often. So David asks three things of God: to remove the stain of his sin from his life, to forgive him, essentially. David asks God to forget his sin, and ultimately he asks God to remove sin from his life. Now, if you're familiar with this psalm, you know that it has a pretty scandalous backstory. So I'll give you just the Cliff's Notes version here. While idle and neglecting his kingly duties, David finds himself captivated by the beauty of a married woman named Bathsheba. So David leverages his power as king and has Bathsheba brought to him. They have an affair, though I'm guessing Bathsheba didn't have much of a say in the matter. Bathsheba becomes pregnant with David's child. So David calls for Bathsheba's husband to come back from the war, back from where David himself should be, thinking that if Bathsheba's husband Uriah comes back and they sleep together, Uriah and everyone else will think that it's his baby Bathsheba is pregnant with, and no one will be the wiser. And friends, seriously, as much as it might sound like it, this is not from an episode of The Young and the Restless, okay? This is straight out of the Bible, straight out of David's life. Well, Uriah won't go home. Won't go, he says, to enjoy the company of his wife while his fellow soldiers are back in the fighting. So David tries to get him drunk, maybe persuade him that way. Uriah still won't go home. So David sends Uriah back to the war. And he gives the commander explicit instructions: send Uriah to the front lines. And when the fighting gets hot, have everybody else pull back so Uriah is sure to be killed. And get killed in the fighting, he does. Ultimately, it was God's prophet Nathan who confronted David with his sin and humbled David before the Lord and brought David to this point where we find him here in Psalm 51. Again, because David knew God, and because David had a God-informed conscience, we'll say, David knew that he just couldn't live with what he'd done. He writes in verse 3, "I am conscious of my rebellion, and my sin is ever before me." So I think this gives us pause to consider how God is informing our conscience, how God is teaching us right from wrong, so to speak. What space we're making in our lives for God to speak to us. How do we maintain God's shalom in God's creation? And how do we keep from disrupting the shalom that God intends? David had this. David had a close walk with God. David had a God-informed conscience. David obviously had people in his life like Nathan to help remind him of all of these things when he was getting off track, we'll say, to put it very, very mildly. But I find it interesting what David writes in verse 4. He says, in this not-so-private conversation with God, he says, "Against you, you alone, God, I have sinned and done this evil in your sight." Really? Against God alone, David sinned? I don't know. If I were Bathsheba in this scenario, I would feel pretty sinned against, wouldn't you? If I were Uriah, I would feel pretty sinned against. I mean, on a theological level, I get it. When we sin against God. I get that. But what David had to know, and what we have to realize as well when it comes to sin, our sin doesn't just affect us. Sin leaves destruction in its wake. Sin disrupts God's shalom. Now, if we're talking degrees of sin here, David sins with idleness and lust and abuse of power, an extramarital affair, deception, manipulation, murder. I'd say these carry a lot more sin weight than, say, the unpaid parking tickets in your glove box. But let's just take the sin of greed, for example. Does my greed affect just me? Of course not. My hoarding or gouging or indifference in terms of money most definitely affects other people. My greed would prevent me from meeting the needs of others, and depending on my position, my greed could keep other people desperate and other people impoverished. Absolutely, my sin affects other people. Absolutely, my sin disrupts God's shalom. See, this is fundamental Christian theology, theology 101, we might say. Most people recognize, and Christian people definitely recognize, there is something wrong with the world. There is something wrong with people. Something's off. And here's where I find what N.T. Wright calls the four-chapter gospel so helpful. See, again, the big narrative with revivalist Christianity especially is largely a two-chapter gospel. Fall and redemption, the fall of humankind, and then Jesus comes and redeems us. Wright argues, and I would say rightly so, that this is only half the story. These are just two chapters of a four-chapter gospel. The Christian story does not begin with the fall of humankind. Our story begins with a good creation. That's chapter one. And then there's the fall and the redemption of Christ, chapters 2 and 3. And then chapter 4, the whole point of it all, restoration. The redeemed work with God. And God works with the redeemed, in and through the redeemed, to restore creation to its intended goodness, its intended shalom. David writes about the redeeming effects of knowing God's forgiveness in real life, how God works in one's life and brings change in one's life. David writes in verse 6 about the integrity that God desires, about how God teaches us wisdom if we're willing to listen and learn and live by it. And this is David's desire, verse 10, create a clean heart for me, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. David's writing here has resonances of the new birth that Jesus talks about in John chapter 3. It has resonances as well of the new heart and the new spirit that God promises to the prophet Ezekiel. God says, a new heart I will give you, a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove from your body the heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. So David began this psalm with confession, right? And like I said, when it comes to our sin, confession is a great place to start. But confession, kind of on its own, I'm not going to say it's useless, but it's pretty close. Because confession doesn't really amount to much without repentance. See, now, as we follow David's writing in Psalm 51, David is now getting into the realm of repentance. David is now writing about the transformation, the changes he wants to make in his life, and the resolve to stay on that path. And these are the fruits of loving God, not fearing God exclusively, but also loving God because God first loved us. See, if David were motivated by fear of an angry deity, David would just do whatever he needed to do in order to placate the angry deity and go back to business as usual. But instead, we see that David is motivated by love, right? Because David knows a God of love. This is why it grieves David to know that he grieved God with his sin. This is why David doesn't ever want to grieve God again. Because who wants to hurt someone that they love, right? And someone that loves them back? Who wants to hurt them over and over again? Now, friends, here's the danger. It is much easier to go through life with a heart of stone, isn't it? A heart of stone can't be hurt. A heart of stone can't be affected. But when God swaps out our heart of stone and gives us a heart of flesh feels. A heart of flesh can be hurt. A heart of flesh can be moved by the suffering of others. In short, a heart of flesh cares. A heart of flesh loves. Our work of redemption and restoration cannot be accomplished with a heart of stone. The needs for redemption and restoration, needs within, needs around us, cannot even be perceived with hearts of stone. David says, "For you have no delight in sacrifice. If I were to give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased. The sacrifice acceptable to God," David writes, "is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." So friends, when it comes to dealing with the sin in our lives, God doesn't want empty religion. Going through the churchy routine and the motions, this doesn't mean much to God. God loves us. So we start there. God loved us into existence. God blessed us with a good creation. Out of love, not fear, but out of love, we need to confess to God where and when we've messed up God's good creation. We offer God our broken spirit. God will take it and give us a new one. We offer God our broken heart, and God will take it and give us a new one. 1 John 1:9 says that if we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So when we've disrupted God's shalom, creation's shalom, we confess that to God because we love God. And because God loves us, God forgives us when we confess our sins. Because we love God, we resolve to change and to live justly in this world that God created. And because God loves us, and not just us, but all of creation, God promises to help us with a new spirit and with a new heart, that God's shalom might be restored and realized in our lives and in our world. God referred to David as a man after God's own heart. Even amid all the sordidness of just this one episode of David's life, God still considered David a man after God's own heart. This should give us some kind of an idea of the limitless depths of God's forgiveness. It should also give us a pretty good idea of the depth of God's love for us. So if our overarching story is about placating an angry and wrathful and vengeful God, we might want to rethink that. David would have been toast if that were the case. And this is not a call to take sin lightly. God loves God's creation, and God wants the best for God's creation. So when that shalom in creation is disrupted, when that peace and that flourishing and well-being is disrupted, God takes this very seriously. But the big story here is not that God wants to zap us. God wants to fix us. A new heart, a new spirit, a new creation that's not only good for us, but good for everyone and everything. We sin. We confess. God forgives. God transforms. And together, we restore shalom, everything as it should be. Amen. Let's pray together. God, we read the words of this great figure, David, a shepherd, a king, a man after your own heart. David is a person just like us, capable of great good, capable of great evil. God, today we confess, like David, that we have sinned. We have disrupted your shalom, and we have failed to do good that would have restored your shalom in your world. We confess, and we make the same requests of you today that David made so long ago. Give us clean hearts, O God, and give us steadfast spirits to live justly in your world. May we never doubt your love, God, and may we never take it for granted. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. To the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Mistakes. Come today, there's a reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes, a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to
yeah.
treasure you found.
Psalm 51:17, the sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Sin breaks our hearts, not only because of the ways sin disrupts our relationship with God, but also because of the ways sin disrupts God's intended shalom in our world. But if there's one thing we can say for sure about God, God is never finished. Not even with broken things. Author and evangelist Vance Havner says that God uses broken things. He says it takes broken soil to produce a crop, broken clouds to give rain, broken grains to give bread to give strength. Tonight at 7, we break bread together around God's communion table. How else could God reveal God's love for us, but for Christ to die for us while we were yet sinners? Tonight, we'll confess our sin. Tonight, we'll receive God's forgiveness anew. Tonight, we'll receive the bread and the cup that heals our brokenness and gives us strength to restore God's shalom in God's world. Now, speaking of God working in and with broken things, we want to thank all those who donated their time this past Thursday and donated their much-needed blood in this pandemic. Once again, we were able to fill up our schedule completely from noon to 6 p.m., so we thank you for that, and we give God the glory. Also, Pastor Kelsey and I are always in prayer for our people, and especially for those lately who work in some capacity in our school system. So again, we really want to lift you up in a special way next Sunday during worship. So please get a photo of yourself to Pastor Kelsey, and we will do just that. We are very grateful for you, and we are certainly praying for you in this very uncertain time. Well, I hope you're able to come for communion tonight, and I hope this week you come to know even more the God who loves us all so much. Amen. Go in peace.